Alison was born in Port Elizabeth on September 22, 1967. She grew up there with her dad, Brian, mom, Claire, with whom she had always shared an incredible bond with, and her brother, Neil, who was 18 months older than her. Her parents had divorced when Alison was only 10 years old, and thereafter, her and her brother lived with their mother. Alison matriculated in 1985 as head girl at the Collegiate High School for Girls in Port Elizabeth. After returning home, she worked as an insurance broker and lived in a quiet complex in the city. She was just 27 at the time of the attack. That day was spent at the beach, then home eating pizza and playing games. That evening, Alison offered a friend a lift home, had picked up laundry, and upon returning home, found her reserved parking spot had been taken, so she had to park further away from home than she was accustomed to. As she put the car in park and began wrestling her keys out of the ignition, Alison suddenly felt a knife at her throat and heard an ominous voice say, "Move over, or else I'll kill you." Alison had not locked all of her car doors. She, as most people would, even through our mind's negativity bias, slaked off the worst of ominous thoughts and convinced herself to remain calm. Surely this man would take what he wanted and leave her alive. The man had even stated that he didn't want to hurt Alison. He just needed to use her car for about an hour. The man told her that his name was Clifton, and he began casually flirting with Alison, asking her about her relationship status, where she went to school, what kind of friends she had. All of this led to giving her a false sense of security. She must have felt reassured as he was speaking to her so softly and caressing her so gently. After driving around, seemingly without aim, the driver pulls over and picks up another passenger. This man was big, tall, dirty, and above all, quiet. He had entered the back seat without so much as a whisper. Alison recounts meeting his gaze on occasion through the rear view. That's when her reassurance began churning into fear, descending into terror. In those eyes was a palpable evil, the likes of which she had never known. His odd gaze was cold, dead, and evil. That was the moment Alison resigned to the fact she was never going home again. They drove her out of town. As they drove further away from the lights and the last vestiges of hope, it all seemed so surreal. Soon they would be driving deep into the darkness. Now, deep in the woods, the car finally comes to a stop. As Franz puts the car in park, he simply turns to Alison and asks, "Are you going to fight?" Alison knew, even though she didn't answer, that there was no way that she was going to be able to fight them off. They exited the car, and Franz forced her to perform oral sex on him, and then he performed oral sex on her. After this, Franz put her back in the car and began to rape her. The rape began rather gently, and because of this, Allison's body was responsive, which she viewed as the ultimate betrayal. After Franz finished raping her, he then politely invited his friend, Theuns, to quote-unquote make love to her, to which Theuns replied, "Nah, I'm gonna fuck the bitch." Franz, who had just finished raping Alison, began bizarrely defending her to Theuns, claiming he should not speak to her in that manner. She was a lady after all. Theuns descended on her quickly and brutally. His hands closed tight around her throat as she slowly lost consciousness. The last thing Alison remembered was her bowels emptying. After raping Alison repeatedly, they stabbed her 37 times in the abdomen and pubic region. Theuns was the first to cut her throat, and Franz pushed him out of the way. Franz would slash, slice, and stab Allison's throat 17 times. The way they left was broken into muddled bits of feet trailing away, and her car seemed to slink into the distant darkness, driven by a man drunk on adrenaline. They tossed her clothes from the car, discarding them like detritus from a fast food binge. Allison, still holding on to life, could not feel any pain. The realization set in that she was injured beyond hope and that she was inevitably in the process of dying. Resigning to her death, her body seemingly began to float. Soon, she had the sensation of hovering above her mangled frame, taking in every nuance of the horrifying scene below her. Alison floated higher still, and the noise from her severed throat completely stopped. Everything stopped. She floated on in silence. At one point, Alison is far from her body, but somehow knows it's not too late to go back. She felt as if she had a choice to make, and quickly decided she wanted to go back. Allison's motivations were simply that she wanted a chance to live her life better. No sooner had she made that decision than she was slammed back into her body, and the awful noise from her fatally wounded throat had returned. Allison knew that she had first and foremost the obligation to reveal the identities of her attackers. She scrawled their names into the dirt and gravel beside her. Franz and Theons. Below that, she simply wrote, "I love Mom." It was at some point after this, Alison felt a wet sensation on her legs. She looked down to realize they had stabbed her so brutally that she had been disemboweled. Allison's intestines were laying outside of her body, and her legs were on top of them. Nearby, she noticed a denim shirt. She recalls grabbing the shirt, collecting her bowels with it, and using the shirt to tuck them back into her body. She crawled in the direction she had seen her assailants drive off in her car. The crawling weakened Allison's brutalized body. She stated that she knew she had to do better. This was when she attempted to stand. Allison somehow managed this incredible feat. Once standing, Allison states that everything almost went completely black. Allison put her hand to her throat and was shocked to find that she could place her hand in its entirety within the gaping wound. They had severed the muscles on the right side of her neck, and her head had flipped back and was dangling between her shoulder blades. Astonishingly, that is when Allison took her other hand and pulled her head back up into a relatively normal position so that she could see. I quote, "It was as if someone else lifted me straight up off my feet and removing them for me. The next thing I knew, I was at a road." After Allison realized this, she collapsed. Within a very short amount of time, and to Allison's complete amazement, a vehicle did approach and slowly came to a stop. She was completely helpless at this point. She states that she had fought to get there, but the fight had gone out of her. And then a horrifying thought entered her mind. What if this was Franz and Theons coming back? Then, abruptly, the car sped off. However, Allison didn't have a lot of time to process this, as very shortly after, another car did approach. This time, a 20-year-old veterinary tech student studying at Technicon in Pretoria named Tion Ellard would be the pilot. He had been on vacation in Port Elizabeth with friends. As he stopped the vehicle, he and his friends jumped out and ran to Allison, who was lying naked in the middle of the road. When he got to her, she was clearly frightened, weak, and unresponsive. They were fortunate in that one of his friends had a cell phone. Remember, this is 1994. Cell phones were a new technology back then, so for one of them to have one was quite a stroke of luck. They quickly phoned emergency services. Tian recounts that they were located from the hospital maybe 15 minutes away at most. They waited 20 minutes, then 30 minutes. Allison is near death and completely unresponsive. However, it would take the ambulance nearly an hour to arrive. Once they had Allison loaded up and were en route to the hospital, Tian urged the paramedic to drive faster, but it seemed as if neither paramedic were significantly concerned. It was like they had resigned to the fact that Allison was not going to make it, and so why rush? They were wrong. The doctor, who examined Alison, stated that he had dealt with a lot of trauma throughout his career as a doctor and scientist, but had never seen anything so brutal or savage. Allison's neck was cut from ear to ear, the trachea and windpipe completely ripped apart. Allison was breathing through a large hole in her neck just above her collarbones. She had been completely disemboweled. Her small bowel lay in large loops outside of her stomach. The intestines themselves were riddled with sand, charcoal, bits of glass, gravel, and a substance that looked like lamb chop fat. After examining the inside of her abdomen and seeing the extent of her injuries, it was determined that if Allison were to survive, she would never bear children. Botha's statements helped lead to the arrest and conviction of Francis Detoit and Theons Kruger, who were each given life sentences for rape and attempted murder. They are currently eligible for parole, though petitions have continually circulated to keep them in prison, and they have been denied parole thus far. Leave comments below, and thanks for listening.